So, like I said, as a historian, I feel like I like chronology, and so I think that way. So I've organized this to kind of continue to some extent, but I'm trying to balance a few things here. I think you can see that. And one is that I'm interested in the themes of the event, but on the other hand, I know that me just diving into the themes and talking about them might assume some prior knowledge that in some of your cases might not be there. So we're small. I don't really mind if you want to interrupt me and ask me questions as I go for clarifications. But on the other hand, I also don't want to spend all my time just sort of doing like a beginning art class. So because I want to, particularly in this part of the discussion, get into some thorny critical issues that are bedeviling Cambodia and Thailand. So I'm going to cut a lot of ground. And like I said, just stop me if you want some clarification, or we can talk about it afterwards. But I do want to talk about some nitty-gritty stuff here without having necessarily to explain everything, which is what I'm saying. So I want to use this part of the discussion, and not so I end it.
Well, since we started a few minutes late, let's go to about 10 after 12 or so. We'll add that time on the end.
Okay. So I'm gonna frame this also in historiographic terms, but maybe even more so than the previous discussion, and think about kind of the perspective of hindsight as we look at past periods of time and the way that they're often sort of framed in this interesting discourse of golden ages, of these sort of ages of perfection, and how it's really almost frankly impossible to completely disentangle oneself, however historically minded or sort of objective they want to be with regard to the evidence, that the paradigms are to some extent set by the idea of classicism in these golden ages, by which I mean in Thailand and Cambodia, periods of time like Angkor for Cambodia, which of course wasn't only a Cambodian phenomenon, but it's been understood as essentially anticipating the modern Cambodian nation state, frankly quite problematically. In Thailand, Sukhothai and Yutia, these kinds of ideas. And the reason I want to do this is because I want to think critically about the way we think about the past and the way we frame it. And in part, I'm also thinking in terms of this event as kind of pedagogical and to give you a sense of how I think about a curriculum of Southeast Asian art history. There aren't very many of them, so I kind of am creating it. There's only a few schools that have Southeast Asian art history curriculums, and so I've created my own, and I'm always trying to balance the needs of students of various constituencies, whether they be from the region or general American students who maybe have no sense of where even Cambodia and Thailand are on the map, but also wanting to have thematic, interesting classes. So I do some classes that are the art history of Thailand, the art history of Angkor, but I also do a class, for example, called Nationalism and the Monumental Past in Southeast Asia, which is essentially a kind of iteration of what I want to do here. It's a more thematic, politicized kind of discussion, using kind of a critical, theoretical approach to the ideology, the rhetoric, the discourse of nationalism, to think about how we talk about the past. So I have a map here that kind of shows some of what I'm going to be talking about. So like I said, I don't really want to give I've done another NEH context, so I don't want to do it today like the art history of Angkor or regards to Sukhothai, but I'm going to briefly introduce them. Angkor, of course, located here in northwestern Cambodia, is a site, is a center with a much bigger sort of historical geography and hinterland and all of that. Similarly, Sukhothai up here in north central Thailand, and I'll mention Yutia as well, and there are other sites in here as well, but these are these historical centers, not really bounded by linear features, as we now know, thanks to the work of various scholars, and of course, there's the model that Odin de Wolters expounded on, the mandala concept, which didn't emphasize linear borders so much as pulsating centers. Tambaya also did this galactic polity concept. So political centers that manifested themselves from these ritual, political, often monumental centers and power emanating out in these concentric zones, if you will, though not perfect circles, of course, but concentric zones of diminishing authority that were ebbing and flowing in relation to each other and constantly sort of shifting and jockeying as maybe the king ruling from the center or the chief, whatever, sovereign was able to negotiate political alliances, marriages, exchange ceremonies, these kinds of things. So what you have is a ever kind of shifting, almost a concertina kind of idea that Wolters had, rather than these sort of constantly reified linear borders on maps that we now associate our national sort of sense of self with, where of course, as is often discussed in the work of people like Anderson and Gellner and Hobsbawm, right? The idea of sovereignty as being, in the modern nation state concept, being coterminous with some sort of dominant ethnicity and language for one thing, but not radiating and pulsating out from the center and fluctuating, at least theoretically, on the nation state model, powers exercised evenly from the capital to the limits of a border where it immediately ceases and is completely replaced by somebody else's sovereignty. And therefore, those borders are of immense importance and have to be delineated and emphasized repeatedly in our minds to the point where we're raised in school so we can draw the perfect outlines of our countries at least we used to be, and that kind of thing. So I want to sort of problematize this model and think about these kinds of ancient centers. But to do that, we also have to go back to kind of historical periods. Angkor Wat, of course, is pivotal in these configurations, especially from the Cambodian perspective. It's the national logo of the country. It's a kind of national symbol. It's the Easter Bunny, Uncle Sam, the eagle, the dollar bill, all rolled up in one, the Statue of Liberty, right? It's the national logo of Cambodia. But that, in and of itself, has an incredibly interesting history. It's not self-evident. It had a process of becoming that. This was built as a Hindu temple to the god Vishnu, who we talked a lot about previously. And it had connections to these relationships between art and power that I was talking about previously. So I want to talk to you a little bit about this. And I want to chart a little bit the vicissitudes of this monument using a kind of a biographical approach, amongst other things I'm going to do here, to try to talk about how meaning shifts over time. One thing that art historians have rightly been criticized for, I think, sometimes, at least in the past, was we like to talk about the way or the circumstances of the original circumstances of artwork in its original context. It's not entirely true that that's all that art historians focus on, but it does tend to be the point of emphasis, especially when you look at our textbooks and like Gardner's Art Through the Ages and things. We don't spend a lot of time thinking about how art changed over time, how the meaning changed, and also how the form of it changed, for that matter. This has changed quite a lot, but I want to definitely do that in this case here. Of course, these kind of golden age legacies are associated often with kings. This, of course, relates to the emergence of these big states or these polities, Angkor, Subutai, and Utio, which are often associated with these great kind of founder kings. For Angkor, it was, of course, Jayavarman II, a largely mythical figure, quite frankly. Jayavarman II, who supposedly in 802 established Angkor as a polity. Angkor Wat, remember, is one temple of dozens at the site of Angkor, which is a term that we use for both the site as well as the kingdom and the period. This is Jayavarman VII. Are argued often to be sort of the greatest of Angkor's kings, late 12th to early 13th century. Jayavarman II was said to have established Angkor's power, but he left us no inscriptions. He's mentioned in other inscriptions. Clearly later kings thought he was important, but we have really no evidence of his own life from his own lifetime. So I regard Jayavarman II as semi-mythological, but he reflects the Southeast Asian penchant for these kind of founder kings. Certainly Jayavarman VII in his own right is kind of a founder king. He ruled Angkor as what you regard kind of at its peak. But he's important because of his personality, a very charismatic figure, a big builder, and clearly he seems to have espoused and endorsed the Buddhist perspective, the one that's quite a bit different from the form of Buddhism we find in Cambodia today, but nevertheless is seen as sort of a pivotal figure in Cambodian history as we shift from this very much Shiva Hindu kind of orientation of most of the Angkorian period to the later Angkorian middle period, post-Angkorian period of Cambodian history, which went more towards Buddhism. And of course, one of the principal national icons of Cambodia today, again, all over government ministries and signs and all that kind of thing, is this image here, regard to the portrait of a man. So we have these different kinds of lenses that the nation has understood, and Angkor Wat's one, Jayavarman the Seventh is another. In Thailand, there's similar configurations, and I'm really simplifying a lot here, so I'm happy again to discuss this or take questions, but we don't have so much time. Rom Kham Heng, King Rom Kham Heng, of course, regarded as a sort of founding figure in Thai national becoming. This is, of course, a recent image, 60s. cast in bronze. It reflects a penchant tradition in modern Thailand where the government, through its ministries, has really been a major patron of the arts, especially in these historic realist portraits of all the great kings and many great kings and heroes of Thai tradition. And there are hundreds of these dispersed all over Thailand. They're connected to, of course, Silpakorn, the Fine Arts University there in Bangkok, and the great Pirasi Karadaferochi, an Italian who was brought in to train in the early 20th century. He was there for decades, really, founding father of Thai modern art, who brought like an Italian sensibility of heroic nationalism, almost a militarized perspective, right? It's almost fascistic approach to art making that has permeated to this day official art making in Thailand. And certainly there are plenty of arts doing other things, but from the perspective of the state. This is just a recent image of Rom Khom Hengmen, who's regarded in Thai national historiography as the founding father of Thailand, basically, in the kingdom of Sukhothai, where he's probably, based upon the models we have, maybe the third king of Sukhothai, who left us an inscription that's highly debated, but it's an inscription that seems to indicate a kind of declaration of independence. It seems to set up a kind of a foil against some other, in which this king was said to be this benevolent father figure who didn't collude with bad people and didn't steal from his subjects and didn't rule capriciously and arbitrarily. Who is the contrast? What is the foil that they're referring to? The typical interpretation is that it's Angkor. We don't really know this for sure. But it seems to suggest that there's a different Thai order, a Mulan order, the Thai city settlement being established, beginning maybe at Sukhothai. Of course, this is historically not true. There were other developments taking place, but we understand from the Thai perspective that in the late 13th century, we have the rosy dawn bliss of the becoming of Thailand, basically, at a site called Sukhothai. Similar to the Khmer perspective on Angkor, and especially Jaipong in the 7th Angkor. These ideas, of course, circulated tremendously in the late 19th and early 20th century. This is a little bit late image to illustrate this point, but I like the picture. But anyway, in Cambodia, of course, this regard for the past and the way it's been studied in modern contemporary terms and has permeated our understanding of the region and the region's self-understanding of itself began in Cambodia, especially with French archaeologists. I'll talk more about them in a little while. As Cambodia was colonized in the latter half of the 19th century. In Thailand, the French archaeologists were active as well, but a lot of sort of princes and kings of Siam, of Thailand, and princes of the royal family became antiquarians, became art historians, and contributed vitally to our knowledge of the region and its history, but also imparted their own political circumstances and to the way that we regard the past. This is King Rom the VI, right, the Jirbut. This is the son of the great King Chula Longkorn. But he himself was a pioneer of Thai antiquarianism and emphasized Sukhothai more than anybody before him. He visited Sukhothai and styled himself as one of these sort of mythical early kings of Sukhothai who traveled the ancient road and really emphasized Sukhothai as the becoming of Thai-ness in Thailand. At the same time, he's emphasizing that trifocal lens of Thai identity, emphasizing, of course, veneration of the king, the language of Thai, and of course Buddhism. Right? And this, to some extent, was emphasized as in distinction to this atrophied old order of Hindu and Angkor. In fact, Khmer Empire, so called, right? In fact, included a lot of places beyond Cambodia, and I don't think we necessarily ought to be associating it exclusively with Khmer people at all. A lot of different ethnic groups would have been enfolded in this space, and this is just a theory. Again, it's a useful learning tool, but I almost hesitate to use these kind of maps because at best this might have been a glimpse of a moment of some kind of authority wielded, but there were no lines or borders or anything to indicate this, and in fact this is wildly optimistic up here. It's probably wrong. But this is an idea of maybe during Jayavarman in the 7th reign of to some extent of what his territorial or authority extent might have reached to these areas. It certainly included at times a lot of southern Laos and portions of what is today Thailand, or east central Thailand, maybe off and on briefly down the peninsula, parts of southern Vietnam, but never really like this. In the very various different time periods, this would have been really fluctuating quite a lot. But I would just like to suggest that we do not, in fact, know the ethnicity of any of these people. None of them. Jaywar the Seventh probably wasn't Khmer. There's good evidence to suggest that he was another ethnic minority group that today live in northern Cambodia. It's pretty good evidence, and some French scholars are working on this. Now, I'm not trying to say that we shouldn't then regard Angkor as vital in understanding the Khmer identity. I would just like to say that it was a far-flung Roman Empire kind of situation that we're dealing with here, and to exclusively associate with one ethnicity, or therefore with one sort of national space, one country, I think is problematic. Angkor bloomed on the lake of Tonle Sap, really in the 9th and early 10th century. That's a massive inland freshwater thing. It's a phenomenon unparalleled anywhere really on Earth, where due to monsoon rains and the backing up of the waters of the Mekong, the Tonle Sap River reverses itself in a lake that in the dry season is a foot deep, maybe 2,500 square kilometer marsh, becomes 15,000 square kilometers and 30 feet deep. It's this engine that was, to this day though, the dams on the headwaters of the Mekong in China are starting to affect this, pulsating constantly, creating a kind of engine of life, very interesting, in which the waters would expand and inundate forests and the fish would feed like mad, and then the waters would sort of recede and dry up and the fish are just there for the taking, right? And so it was a natural resource abundance that made sense for there to be a massive sort of civilization to develop really all across its northern shores. And of course, Angkor's famous and becoming more so ongoing archaeology for this engine of hydraulics, webs of hydraulics that expanded across this landscape in very complex ways. Canals, dikes, dams, all kinds of interesting features that were built to harness these waters. And clearly they were articulated in ideological terms in terms of these temples and their big arrays and the moats that surrounded them. So you get this massive cosmology that developed as Angkor over centuries became this huge urban conurbation, right? And people debate what its population was. Was it 750,000 at its peak or a million? But it was a big place. One of the biggest sort of urban configurations on Earth at the time. Certainly China and Rome were bigger in their, certainly Chang'an, for example, in China, Xi'an, were probably bigger in their heyday, but it was a big center. Not laid out like our cities though, so we have to think of different kinds of urban models. One that's advanced is the gossamer city is like a spider web rather than like an urban center with a downtown area and suburbs, right? Instead, people were living along canals, along these linear features, basically, sort of stemming out from the ceremonial center, like a spider web. But you had these big tanks that were built, clearly with cosmological significance, but that also served riparian purposes as well, because there were big water reservoirs where the water, flood waters could be bunded, and then as the waters receded, then it could be channeled off in various complex ways. To this huge, far-flung landscape. Now we see it as almost all of what is today northern Cambodia was incorporated into this. These archaeologists are doing all this aerial survey, LIDAR, remote sensing kind of stuff, and they're finding all these interesting things. Big, big center though. Famous, of course, and associated for all of its architecture. And this has dominated our thoughts on the society, and it's mostly architectural historians that have written the history, and a epigrapher is working with them. They've sort of written the history of the period. Now archaeology is helping to clarify some things, though they're still mostly operating in the framework set by these earlier scholars, frankly. But you have these great temples, of course. Most these are all at Angkor, big sort of city of temples, of course. These were not residences, these were not palaces. The kings lived in wooden structures that were near these structures. These batteries for power that I was talking about. They're cosmological power producers, where they replicate the structure of the cosmos as a mountain. In Buddhist and Hindu texts, we have extensive examples of the whole cosmos is understood as a mountain, a central peak where the gods dwell, or even in Buddhism, where you're understood as attaining higher spiritual attainment as you go up these mountain peaks, Mount Meru, Mount Kailasha, there are these different names for them. They're surrounded by slightly smaller foothills and ultimately by a cosmic sea. It's precisely the model of the heavens that's being built in these kinds of monuments on Earth, bringing heaven to Earth, but not as a picture, as magic. It's clear from their inscriptions that this is relocating heaven to Earth, creating a pivot between heaven and Earth through physical likeness. So you create a microcosm of a macrocosm, and therefore the benefits of the macrocosm accrue to the microcosm. A cosmic pivot, an axis mundi, all of these kinds of ideas inherent in these kinds of radial temples, and oftentimes that's the way they're laid out. With the central shrine on the very top, with the god, usually Shiva, enshrined in there as usually a linga. So bringing the blessings from heaven to earth and then radiating outward, right, in this kind of centrifugal kind of dynamic. Conceptually, to the extent that people venerated these sites, and they were mostly sites for ritual practice, which probably they were, you conceptually move more towards the center, move up to the mountaintops, the abode of the gods, to the center of the cosmos, to the navel of the universe. These are producers of power associated with royal prerogative, but they're not symbols, they're not pictures, they're not legitimate. They are the basis of the understanding of how power operated. It's very, very clear. Now, we could also, I went back to my room and added these last night. Luckily, I had some stuff on my computer, but since we have some nice pottery here, I wanted just to say that Angkor also was a great pot-producing tradition, though that's very poorly understood. It's long been admired by collectors, but it's really only in the last 10 years that we have really leapt ahead with our understanding of Angkorian ceramics, because now we have an abundance of kiln sites that have been located and are starting to be excavated. So we're now in a position of being able to move from sort of connoisseurial value of these things and to write a real genuine kind of history and technological development. But certainly, Angkor was a great pot producer, but there are interesting historical conundrums and questions. It seems that they also imported a lot of Chinese wares, and that some people think that the availability of good Chinese and later Vietnamese wares might have kind of led to a certain lack of development in the Khmer context. That's an interesting question. I don't know if that's true, but we'll have to see what the archaeologists reveal. So we have these really nice kind of examples, and there's one back there, very much like this, right? Anthropomorphic, zoomorphic forms. These animal forms were probably used for lime-based pots for chewing beetle, because they've been found with the like atrophied, petrified limes stuck to the interior. You get reliquaries like this that probably were for some sort of sacred deposit, maybe the ashes, and they evoke this cosmic symbolism that I was just mentioning. So they're actually built very much on the model and very much like the architecture. It's this recurrent symbolism. You see it in the form of the temples, you see it on the temples, in the mythological scenes themselves, you see it in the pots as well. These kind of tiered cosmos kind of symbols, right? Mount Meru here kind of evokes also lotus and fruit. All of these associations are quite intentional. I think it's important work that Ian Abbott did in the 70s and 80s, where he really clarified how much Khmer ancient inscriptions in Sanskrit and Old Khmer are built on double entendre, and there's all this like nested and layered kind of symbolism, intentional. So for a while, people interpreted it like they didn't really know what they were doing. I think now I understand that the poetics of it was so sophisticated that it was lost on further scholars. Pots in the shape of turtles, just some examples. Of course, the Buddhist and Hindu cosmological vision has the whole map of the cosmos as a mountain positioned on the back of the turtle. From the Vaishnava standpoint, that's Vishnu. But this varies according to religious perspective. But Angkor Wat is a Vishnu temple. It's a temple that is understood to be resting ultimately on the back of this cosmic turtle, Kurma, an avatar of Vishnu. So Angkor Wat, again, is just one of many of these temples, but it's just so big, it's very impressive. And of course, encomia abound, and that's one of the reasons why it's so emphasized and talked about. You can hardly ever talk about Angkor Wat without, of course, it being told to you that it's the biggest religious structure on earth, and these sort of interesting hyperboles, for sure. Certainly as well preserved, much of it too. So I think that's testament to this. You can see it's a massive space. It's a concentric enclosure, ever higher in the center with these sort of mountain configuration quincunx of towers is what we have here. A central tower where the main deity would have been placed in a small shrine, the deity now lost today. Flanked at the corners by some subsidiary towers which evoke this cosmic symbolism of a mountain and then foothills basically. And that continues as you radiate outwards to the cosmic sea in the form of a moat that surrounds it. You can see it's rendered on a massive scale, huge. Certainly it's a microcosm in terms of the relation to heaven, but it's meant to bring the benefits and power of heaven in this sort of heavy-handed big form right onto earth. So by our perspective, it's massive. massive and huge, but understand that this is meant to be Vishnu's heaven on earth. Famous, of course, for its imagery of Apsaras and celestial maids. We have 1,796 different female figures on, I think, 1,800, basically. Female figures carved in relief, each a little different than the other. That signify, of course, the celestial realm. The term for these is often used as Apsaras, which is this term for these rain spirits, basically. Maybe that term isn't the correct term for all of these figures, because they may have been more important players mythologically than these little rain spirits, is the technical Sanskrit meaning of the word Apsaras. But nevertheless, they signify the celestial realm. They decorate the enclosures as you move into the interior. Of course, you can see in this image the rising central mount here. And I think I wanted to show this. Can you see the mountain form in this? I mean, this is clearly what they're doing here. There's an axis here in the center where the deity's place. This is cut, right? So it's cool. But basically, to give you a sense of the radial configuration of space and the dynamics then of this architectural engine of power, as the power emanates from the center, but it's coming from this cosmic pivot from heaven, basically. And then it's flowing out, radiating out into our landscape, basically.
I don't mean to interrupt.
No,
I just
please.
Have an immediate reaction, thinking about the Mesoamerican monumental sites and how they're designed. This does not seem to encourage community. There's not a lot of open space within the building.
You have a good point. I mean, there is a lot of open space between the enclosures, and archaeologists are desperate to figure out what was going on in there, whether this was cities of people or construction crews or what, because we really don't know what's all this space out here. You're right to bring this up. This cosmic symbolism of mountains is something that occurs architecturally in many cultures throughout the world. You can find examples in China, you can find examples in Mesopotamia, you can find examples in Mesoamerica.
Yeah.
And in Mesoamerica, there are clearly mountains, and they're key to also to cosmological ideas and the understanding of these heavens and Chimbalta and all of these stuff. And they have these long sort of channels that cut down into the interior of those Mesoamerican.
I was thinking specifically of Cahokia.
Mm-hmm.
With the monumental open space, the plazas for trade and ball games, and seem to encourage community where maybe I'm not seeing it on scale.
Well, no, it's big. I think there's different issues here in North, Central, and South America, too. So Mesoamerica, Cahokia, there's some differences and some similarities. I think there's a lot of debate and question over precisely how these spaces were used there. And if you're now looking at ball games, that's a different kind of structure that was often in association with the big mountain forms, but are separate thing altogether too. So there's a whole lot of variables at play. I would just say that there's a shared mountain symbolism. Probably in the Mesoamerican sites, there's not any evidence that average people were going ascending those mountains either.
Unless they were going to their death, but that's a whole.
Or being chucked off or something. Yeah, I mean that is right. Here. People wonder about this. These certainly were not churches, they're not cathedrals, they're not mosques. In the Hindu religious tradition, though, that said, even the biggest Hindu temples, the inner space is invariably tiny. And that doesn't mean that people couldn't go there, it couldn't be for community. It's a different basis for how you interact with God. You don't have congregational worship in Hinduism. You have interactions with God, and there may be an intermediary of Brahmins there, but they're not getting up and preaching to a sermon of massive people. You go there and maybe you get a little advice from your guru, and then you go inside the shrine and circumambulate and offer some milk and honey and things to the linga. But it's done in the confines of a bhakti, this devotionalism, where you're interacting kind of individually with the god in small spaces. So the fact that the spaces in the interiors are small doesn't really mean that it couldn't facilitate what we might call community interaction. But that said, there's no evidence whatsoever that the community had any access to these sites. And really, when we start to look at the architecture of them, they look like they kind of actually almost intentionally don't facilitate easy access. I mean, if you've gone here, they're hard, they're precipitous to climb. There's often towers obstructing what appear to be where we thought people might have circumambulated, but there's no way to get through. It may very well be that what we had here was primarily rituals taking place. The king might have had access, but probably a very complicated sort of priestly system in place. That said, that doesn't mean there wasn't a lot of people. Hundreds of people doing these rituals and that kind of thing, but it wasn't as though like it was a democratic civic space where people gathered for assemblies and things like that. But it's a good question. Probably average people had no access to the interior. probably restricted hierarchy. One of the most famous images from Angkor Wat is a portrait of the king identified by name as Param Vishnu Loka, he who was reborn in Vishnu's realm. And it's interesting that we have an historic scene. This is not unprecedented, by the way. Phnom Rule in Northeast Thailand, another Khmer site, or Angkorian site, who's saying that from the end of the day. But it's a site that slightly predates and is somewhat at the same time period as Angkor Wat, has similar historical scenes, but it seems to be the king and his court. We have extensive reliefs. We could talk about them all day, but I just wanted to show you a portrait of Suryavarman, and then clearly one that is related to it. If you go around the corner to the next gallery, Vishnu, who's the principal divinity of the site based on what we see from the context, the inscriptions, all of that. Notice he's on a turtle, which is himself here, as he's presiding over the cosmic struggle between the forces of the anti-gods and the gods, which is a cosmogonic myth of the origin of the gods. So-called churning of the sea of milk, tug-of-war struggle with the cosmos is embodied by a serpent. It's an ancient story that appears in the Mahabharata, primarily also Ramayana and Bhagavata Purana, other stories as well, from India. It clearly moves very well in Cambodia, because this is the most detailed and biggest portrayal of this event anywhere in the world. It's actually something you find throughout Southeast Asia often, whether it be in Angkor Wat or in Borobudur. They have these ideas and these texts clearly that they knew about, that they got from India or wherever, but then they elaborated on them to a degree that we never see back in the home country for these ideas, right? So again, this adaptation, this exploitation of these ideas. Here is Vishnu as the ultimate deity. He's the ultimate sort of power in the universe, maintaining a balance between these forces that are essentially churning a linga, a mountain, that's rooted on the back of Korma, the turtle, the form of Vishnu, and then Indra, the sky god up here, is sort of pushing down on it, keeping the linga in place, so there's also Shiva here. And the idea is they're churning this pivot, and they're churning up the elixir of immortality in these mists that's down here at the bottom of the cosmic sea. And the gods and the asuras are not yet gods and asuras, they're competing teams of titans, basically, trying to get the elixir of immortality. The gods win. They cheat, but they win. Vishnu helps them cheat. But here he is, basically, the king of this situation, the king of heaven, the dominant power in the universe, omnipotent, omniscient, kind of divine power. Notice his body position here. He's got his forearms. He's holding attributes that we associate with Vishnu. But in fact, it's clear that there's a visual accord and similarity and parallelism being drawn here between the king and his court and Vishnu at the next gallery. They're at the center point of their respective compositions that converge on these figures. This kind of artistic composition and deployment of imagery and space is recurrent throughout Angkorian tradition. We could have many examples, but this is just one I wanted to show you. Of course, these temples fundamentally created a kind of dualism between the king and the god. Does this mean that the kings were worshipped as gods in some sort of oriental despotism? Probably not. But what it suggests is that the kings sought a kind of apotheosis after death, a kind of posthumous divinity, where they would go to the god's heaven and be reborn in the god's heaven. When ruling on earth, they were said to have a component of the god with them. But these temples have, therefore, a kind of a funerary association. Not like pyramids, because there is no deposit of a bunch of grave goods or anything like that, but a kind of conceptual funerary purpose where essentially they were engines of power production in the king's reign, and they assured the king's apotheosis, the linkage of the king with his chosen god, usually Shiva, but in the case of Angkor Wat, Vishnu, in the afterlife. And it's really fundamental to his ancestor worship. It's really extravagant, sophisticated ancestor worship. It's fundamental to what's taking place here. Sukhothai. Like Angkor, so I mean, like I said, I was talking about Angkor, that was really fast, right? I could spend all day talking about it, but I want to talk a little bit about Sukhothai, which also deserves a long treatment, but I want to set up a few things here. Sukhothai, we know a lot about, well, we don't know very much about it, actually. What we know about it is from really just a handful of 30-some-odd inscriptions. This is the most famous of them. Angkor, by contrast, has given us over 1,000 inscriptions, so we know a lot more in the history of Angkor than Sukhothai. But the Ramkhamhaeng inscription, which has been debated over all kinds of issues pertaining to its usefulness as an historical source, to whether or not it's a fake, or whether parts of it are fake, etc., is one of the main inscriptions by which we understand the history of Sukhothai. and other related inscriptions. These are interesting. They give us kind of clues about this polity, but they leave more to be imagined. There's been a lot of imagining that's been done. King Ramkam Hang, of course, in that inscription, I said, is associated with being a kind of a founder king who rules clearly in a kind of Buddhist mindset as this kind of patriarchal, benevolent father figure who really looks after his subjects and doesn't exploit them and doesn't seemingly like waste a lot of resources and that kind of thing. An argument that's often been made by scholars and certainly by Thai nationalists is that he was reacting to Angkor. There's been a debate then what was the link between the origins of Sukhothai and its connection to Angkor. It's not very clear. There is one inscription number 2, that seems to suggest that one of these early kings, or these early kings of Sukhothai, were invested with power in the sacred sword ceremony from a city that we think is Yashovarpura, Angkor. So that there was some sort of connection, and that Sukhothai might have originated as a kind of satellite of Angkor. This is not clear. It's really just one inscription, and it's very vague, and we don't really know the toponyms and what they designate clearly. But that said, the earliest big monumental imagery we have at Sukhothai is clearly related to Angkor, and it's clearly related to the building projects of Jayavarman the VII. So the earliest temples that we have in the Sukhothai area and nearby Sisachthamalai, one of the satellite towns, are clearly derived from Angkorian prototypes and probably are part of a big network of so-called rest houses, fire houses, and hospitals, pharmacopoeia establishments that were built along a network of roads that were primarily associated with the King Jayavarman the VII in Angkor in the late 12th and early 13th century, and where his power was seemingly reaching up into this area, but whether he had political control of this area is totally debatable. Cultural influence is strong. Artistic connections are strong. These forms of monuments are redolently connected to Angkor. They're very clearly, and the statuary that was found in them. Even these kinds of towers, they're ultimately rooted in the tower shrines from the Angkorian period. They gradually developed into what we call the Thai prang, these shrines that are now in a Buddhist context, but still evoke these Hindu ideas as well, kind of shared Hindu-Buddhist substratum that I already talked to a little bit about. Of course, Sisachthamalai, again, near Sukhothai, we're talking about primarily a Buddhist orientation, though they still did commission and make Hindu images in some temples here in this cultural milieu as well. Clearly, though, by the 14th, 15th century, they're very keyed into what had been happening in Myanmar and Sri Lanka. It's at this point where we maybe can start to talk about Theravada Buddhism, though that term itself is not really appropriate yet. But these kind of bell-shaped stupas with elephant around the foundation, these forms go back to the 3rd century in Sri Lanka. Buddhist sites now with these sort of monumental Buddhist figures that prefigure all of the great sort of wats that you see across Thailand, or the kind of Buddhist monastic structures you find in Laos and Cambodia as well, are developing simultaneously in Cambodia, Thailand, and Laos in this increasingly Buddhist milieu that characterizes the period after Angkor more or less declines or collapses in the 15th and 16th centuries. Sukhothai is primarily esteemed in Thailand for its great Buddhic images, a lot of which survive, or at least seem to survive, but as sacred objects in their own right with biographies and associated with power. They can perform miracles. They're very interesting images. This is a particularly famous image. It's believed to be the image that this one is replacing, that was relocated from Sukhothai to Ayutthaya and then subsequently to Bangkok. This one has particular value for the current king. You can by this image. The ashes of the king's brother who mysteriously died by gunshot wound are here. Big images like this characterize the Sukhothai field of art. Again, it's this monumentality, and it seems related to the size matters for sure. These big, impressive establishments, big images of the Buddha, sometimes seated, sometimes standing, famously walking. This kind of image of the walking Buddha seems to have gained special status at Sukhothai. We have a couple of walking Buddha images from earlier in India and from earlier in Myanmar, but they don't walk like this. They don't flow like this. And certainly walking was not primarily what was being indicated in those earlier precedents. At Sukhothai, they really seized on this imagery, and if we had more time, I would like to do it, but I don't want to take the time right now to talk about it as I talked about the Vishnu images and that kind of thing, the way that this reflects a localization, but in a broader dialogue with the Buddhist world. But they're really amazing images, and they largely define the sort of Thai sense of classical perfection. These kind of Sukhothai images with their elegant flowing lines, their kind of liquid grace. You find them, this very image, but similar walking images are all over Thailand in public statuary, and they're referred to in artists' work, whether officially sponsored by the government or contemporary artists. You have reclining images from Sukhothai of great value and beauty as well. Prabhu Chinnarat, many Thais would consider it maybe the most beautiful of Thai Buddha images. It's a late Sukhothai image from the nearby or satellite city of Pilop and Sanulok. This is a Buddha image that really reflects the late Sukhothai style as we understand it, with those really elegant kind of forms, but really not aspiring to what we would call naturalism, rather following, it seems, poetic descriptions of the Buddha with his body, and even like fingers and a flat level tread and these kinds of things. Very, very beautiful images, but really not images. They're like living presences with their own power to perform miracles and punish you if you cross them. Very interesting because they're believed to be inhabited by powerful spirits, king spirits, for example. Cambodia does this very interesting because Cambodia often has the association that Buddha images are inhabited by the most powerful and scary of all spirits. Women who die as virgins or in childbirth, they're the scariest of all spirits, and they take up residence in the bases of Buddha images, and they protect them. But you know, there's this kind of duality, you could call it syncretism or some kind of overlapping connections, but it's very rich. And this is an image that wept when the next period, as Thai national becoming is narrated to us by the Kingdom of Ayutthaya. In fact, there was considerable overlap and relationships, and it wasn't just one center replaced another in a neat succession of periods, but certainly power did rise strongly and had already been developing to the south in the area of Ayutthaya. And Ayutthaya rose as a maritime-oriented society, but in part it did that by being able to tap into the market upriver to the Sukhothai area, which still nevertheless continued, especially its satellite cities. Famous for its ceramic production, especially its beautiful underglazed painted stoneware tradition associated with Si Sop Chen Lai. Seems to have been a primary resource for the expanding of the Ayutthaya economy where these ceramics. Ayutthaya, famous as this big Buddhist kingdom, often tied more expressly by Thai thought to Cambodia, because it's pretty clear here that for at least a while, pretty clear, but it's poorly understood. There's a lot of Khmer influence at Ayutthaya. Ayutthaya, of course, is credited in the Chronicles with sacking and destroying Angkor in 1431 or 32. In fact, the Chronicles give us a bunch of sacks and a bunch of dates. But Michael Vickery says one is authentic, right? 1431, 1432. The idea that somehow Ayutthaya then instantly replaced Angkor is an idea that's firm in the mind of people in Cambodia and Thailand alike. In fact, Angkor continued to be important. It was never really abandoned. There are inscriptions through the 19th century. But there was a shift of power. It wasn't just from Angkor to Ayutthaya. It was from Angkor to Ayutthaya, perhaps also to the northern Laos centers, and also then to the Mekong area north of Phnom Penh. But certainly Ayutthaya thrived as a primarily Buddhist site, famous for its kind of architecture, which represents an interesting confluence of ideas coming from Myanmar, from Sri Lanka, from the Angkorian context. It seems that they used Khmer as a kind of court language at Ayutthaya for quite some time, but again, it's poorly understood because our earliest texts that are in the Khmer that they purportedly use are actually from the late Ayutthayan period. And again, Michael Vickery, a scholar, has shown that in our earliest records of Ayutthaya, the royal titles that they use bear no resemblance to anything in Angkor. And you would expect that if there was this kind of high-level influence that you would see it more clearly, historically, that is. And so it's unclear. It may actually be that the Khmer influences we see at Ayutthaya are a later period, a kind of revival. Like this, King Prasat Khon, 17th century, this temple which seems more similar than other temples in Ayutthaya to the Angkorian style, or the approach, the layout, the configuration, suggesting this cosmology in more clear terms than that use of the prime, which was recurrent at Ayutthaya. But sometimes this period is understood as it's a complicated period, King Prasathan. There's a big dissertation on the art of it by John Listopat, where he talks about it as maybe this connection to Cambodia that's being revived at the time. An interesting site, like Jaiwa Tanaram, that does signal some degree of pretty close cultural connectedness between the Ayutthaya and Khmer culture, Angkor, if you want to call it that, but this expanding sort of Theravada Southeast Asian civilization that's taking place in the early modern period. Now, I rushed through that a little bit because I really want to talk about this because it's going on right now. A temple of the Angkorian period that primarily dates from the 11th century, that sits on the border as it exists today between Thailand and Cambodia, and that is the source of all kinds of conflict and tension, low-level fighting, war in 2008-2011. A really interesting conflict that is still at play. It's right now there's a kind of uneasy stalemate because Cambodia has asked the International Court of Justice again to look at the case. They were supposed to give their opinion in this month, October, but it's now said that it was postponed to February. But the latest news out of Thailand, the foreign minister says it's coming on November 11th at 10 a.m. And you can see that they care about this because they're waiting in bated breath for what the International Court of Justice is going to say about this temple. Why is this such a big deal? Don't talk about it. Pray the here. Kao Phra Lahan is high. Kao Phra Lahan.
I'm sorry. So they're making a decision about ownership of it?
I'll tell you that. I need to. That was a setup.
Oh,
okay. That was pure tease. Now I'm going to talk about it for the rest of my time.
Okay.
So this is a temple, like I say here, it's built in several phases. It's primarily an 11th century temple built by King Suryavarman I. It's a Shaiva temple. But what's remarkable about it, and they did this quite often actually in Angkorian architecture, was to build it on a hilltop, on a mountaintop. In this case, though, it's on a cliff with a literal straight down drop of 500 meters off the backside of the temple, basically. The temple itself is interesting, though, because the way it's constructed, it turned its back on the cliff. It's interesting. Seems to have been some sort of hermitage for Shaiva aesthetics, transcending earth, if you will, attempting union with God. And so therefore they chose this beautiful location with a great perspective across the landscape. You can see it here. But they turned their back on it intentionally. That's quite, I think, interesting symbolism here. Now, of course, our overwhelming concern in modernity is with the perspective from the hilltop. And it's not a good one. It's a contested site. It's a war zone. What we're really talking about when we look at Prayavihara, Kao Phra Lahan, right? So, is a question about the natural becoming of these spaces, which has been much commented on by many scholars. So far be it for me to weigh in here too much, and you can read all about this, especially Tong Chai's great book, Siam Map. Quite a lot, Penny Edwards' book on Cambodge, Cultivation of a Nation, go into a lot of these ideas. But basically, Prayavihara is located right here on the map. So let's get right out there. And it's becoming has a lot to do, and the tumultuousness surrounding that site has a lot to do with the kind of becoming of Angkor and Angkor Wat as metaphor and metonym for state becoming of the modern Cambodian nation. And at the same time, the becoming of Thailand as a modern nation state. This kind of international dialogue that was taking place in the 19th century involving colonization, but also the discourse of monuments and historic preservation, in fact. The idea that architecture represents the apex of human artistic production was very much at play in 19th century European cultural life. Architecture, of course, was the principal form of art in his life, number one, because it represents nations, and in the discourse of the day of race, ethnicity, the great century of race discussion, right? So monuments were tied to races, tied to ethnicities, and were seen to be indicative of their character, and their qualities, and therefore could be ranked, and that kind of thing, right? So at the same time that colonization is taking place, and in part, French colonization in Southeast Asia was compelled, or at least justified very much so by the prominent ruins in the region. that has been discussed, of course, that France, as it lost out in the Seven Years' War in India, turned its attention ever more, it was reduced to its port cities, basically, turned its attention, its direction, its perspective, its colonial ambitions more and more towards Southeast Asia, where it already had connections, of course, through Catholic missionaries and the like. But it's often said that French designs on colony and colonizing on the conquest of mainland Southeast Asia were compensation for the loss of India. And we often see that kind of perspective that permeates them in their early commentary and discourse. For example, Henri Nouveau, who in no way represented the French government because they rejected, he's like Columbus, right? He was a Frenchman who wanted to go explore this area for the good of France and investigate colonial opportunities, but the French wouldn't sponsor him because they were kind of divided in government in terms of what they really wanted to do. So he was sponsored by the British. And he came from Bangkok because, of course, at this time, the Angkorian region was ruled by the Chakri kings, very recently. But from 1793, we think, the area of Angkor and all its ruins, in fact, all of north and western Cambodia, that belongs to Sisipan provinces, were ruled from Chakri base in Bangkok at this point. So he came with Thai guides and went to Angkor, where he was led to the site by local Khmer people. And he left us interesting sketches. He was a botanist. He was primarily interested in recording flora and fauna and that sort of thing. But he still had commentary about the ruins and about the fate of civilizations. And yes, France should certainly look into taking over this area because the people clearly had a great civilization in the past, but they're clearly corrupt and downgraded today. These kinds of famous comments, right? Might have sort of been lost if it wasn't for the fact that he died on the expedition, died in Laos, and his journals came out and were first published in English and then in French in serialized form, and they became this sort of great narrative of white man's burden, kind of, so to speak. In other words, that he realized the value of this place and that it could be a feather in the cap of the French country, the French nation, and that it was this sort of grand adventure story of like Livingston and Stanley, these kinds of stories, right? Henri Nouveau, who sort of is credited with rediscovery of Angkor. In fact, like I said, he was led there. There were other people that were miffed about this. There's a French priest that had already gone there and published and sort of mad that Nouveau got all the credit. Meanwhile, we have inscriptions from the 19th century on the site and all that sort of thing. But it's this lost civilization discourse and it's situated with this fellow. And also with these guys. I love these guys. These are funny. The Mekong Exploration Commission, right? A ragtag bunch of misfits. Clearly, a bunch of rejects from the standpoint of French politics, but if we're coming out here to make fame and fortune kind of in the colonies, right? They all have their unique skill set. They're pretty talented individuals. Assembled here basically to explore the Mekong with the idea that if they could just get a back door into the markets of China by going all the way up the Mekong, they could circumvent the British, who are having such success, right, in terms of maritime trade in China. They wanted that back door connection. So there was this team that was basically assembled. A very capable man, Garnier, this guy who's the de facto leader, but De La Grey was the main sort of naval commander in all this. And then they had a botanist, a geologist, an artist to record things. And he became the first art historian of Cambodian art. And he wrote academic tomes on it, based on their visit to Angkor as they were going up the Mekong. Here they are seated on the steps of Angkor Wat at the beginning of their trip. They look like master and commander, right? Here they are at the end. They're down a couple of guys. They're sick with malaria, dysentery. And I love their probably Vietnamese sort of porters here who look like they're kind of looming like they look up here, kind of behind them, right? And these guys are invariably kind of gone native. They're a bit bedraggled and all of that. But this is the vaunted Mekong Exploration Commission, a great adventure story. And there's a really good sort of popular book you could read, Mad About the Mekong by John McKay. It's not super scholarly in terms of verifying everything, but it's really well written. If you're interested in these kind of 19th century explorer yarns, Mad About the Mekong. It failed, because of course the Mekong is impassable when you get to what is today the border between Laos and Cambodia. The falls there are extensive, dozens of kilometers of of high volume of waterfalls, not a lot of verticality, but impassable, basically. So it basically failed, but it, again, their trek and the serialization of it, and the images that Delaporte left, really created this really romantic fervor that began to bubble up back in the metropole, right, in Paris. So we have Delaporte's really quite nice images that would circulate in these, you know, would circulate in these kind of tout de monde, in these kind of travel journals and serials. And so this is an early image that he left us of Van Gogh, 1873. And you can see he's included himself, and he's got his native sort of attendant who's pulling the trees away so he can get a glimpse of the monument and characterize and all that. Notice though that there's quite a lot of activity in the site, so it looks a little lost to me. I don't know what he's doing here, if he's inserted them or whatever. Kind of picking. Meanwhile, of course, the Chancre kings are getting more and more interested in this because the French are predating, according to the time tradition for sure, on their borders, and we've got the British on the other side, and Burma, and Malaysia, all this ongoing. Of course, these Chakri kings, King Mongkut, King Chulalongkorn, are credited from the Thai perspective with staving off colonization, whether or not this is truly a debate. But clearly they were interested and at the same time trying to secure their own national borders against colonization. And while not colonized, Thailand still employed a lot of the same techniques, right, for governance and administration and internally colonized themselves, as Tong China, which we're talking about. And that could and would have included most of what is today Laos and Cambodia if the French hadn't, through gunboat diplomacy, essentially, and various machinations, cleaved off these parts of what are today Laos and Cambodia from what was being claimed by the Chakri kings, but which had never really historically been part of any Thai historical political formation, right? So this is where you get all of the sort of cleavage between these emerging nation states and how we read back history into the early modern period. King Mongkut, King Rama IV, actually dispatched a team of people to go to Angkor at the very time that all this is taking place, right? Because the French are meddling there. He's claiming that area, though it was ruled primarily through Khmer governors, Bhatan Wong and Sumer. But he sent a team to dismantle a temple from Angkor and bring it back to Bangkok because he wanted sort of a claim of ownership sort of idea. He was run off by rabble-rousers, basically. This is in the chronicle. And so, as compensation, he commissioned a scale model of Angkor Wat to be made. Of course, in his in the palace of Bangkok, you can still see it's there. But it was kind of King Mongkut's effort to stake his claim on this legacy of Angkor, this heritage. So there was this kind of competition between the Thai and the French. Here's another view of it. Of course, Thailand's not the name of the country yet. This is the king. King Rama IV, a very capable guy, whether or not we necessarily credit him with everything that he has been credited with, multilingual, very intelligent fellow, clearly skilled in international diplomacy, famously interacted, of course, with politicians around the world, with Lincoln, offered him elephants, famous story, right? Lincoln said, I'm sorry, the longitude doesn't favor the beast, or something like that, right? But a very capable individual who clearly was aware, because of his smarts and his linguistic skills, with what was taking place around Siam at the time. Now, we know him as a kind of a buffoon, and the Thais don't like this, of course, but this is the guy in various iterations of the story of Anna Lee and Owens and Anna and the King. He's the king presented in that. I think China, in fact, did a fair job, of course, but the Thais banned these movies, of course, officially. Of course, they all watched them officially. But it's the story of this one. I just bring this in just to peg this in case you don't quite have the historical context. I'm not saying necessarily that you should read Anna Lee and Owens' account, as history has been soundly criticized, maybe not entirely fairly in some cases, but this is the woman that's being portrayed in these various movies and musicals and things. And the king's court, I'm talking about this time period, is now. These are the real kids that she was brought in to be the governess to. So if you have a lot of kids. And remember, the famous scene in the movie, of course, the 20th Century Fox version in 56, which is all about Cold War, post-World War II American politics, right? Mm-hmm. Mapped onto this period, so I don't want to go down that road. But it's interesting that we get a map lesson where she instructs the young Thai princes and princesses, especially the man who will become King Chulalongkorn, the young boy, says, man, not so small. That's the next king. So Thais don't like that because he's presented way, right? But she teaches them that this map that they have that shows Thailand as the center of the world basically is wrong. You need to look at it like this. Right? Here's the Mercator projection and all of that. So it's that great scene, the map scene. This is the man that he would become, the young boy shown in that scene. It's a very astute individual, right? Shown here in two different modes, right? Coronation, second coronation, and traditional regalia. And here's the statesman on the European model of the horse, you know, cavalier kind of guy, right? Equestrian kind of character. These have to do with these, of course, the exchanges that were taking place between the Thai government and the United States. Sign was really keen to get the United States to back them and help them, right? Because it was a time where they were facing depredation or colonial intrusion here from the French and the British. Right? At the same time, these are our kings in Cambodia, who are essentially ruling as proxy figures for the Thai court. They were ruling in Phnom Penh at this point. And there's the history is well told by Chandler really quite nicely about the way that the Khmer court was relatively divided, and some royal family would at times side with the Vietnamese, some side with Bangkok, playing them off each other, basically trying to retain a kind of vestige of independence. But the narrative seems pretty accurate. I mean, Cambodia was a place, a region, not yet become Cambodia, but the Khmer lands were largely being divided up by these surgeon powers, basically at Hue, Vietnamese, and at Bangkok, Phuket, Thai. These men uneasily allied themselves with the French to stave off their neighbors. And indeed, the French played that card a lot. They were the saviors. Not saviors, they made Cambodia. Because what they did was they assured territorial integrity, or created it. And this monument, by a Frenchman, commissioned by the French government, to commemorate and honor the king, King Sisavat, right? By offering him as three apsaras in Angkorian style, retrocession of lost territories of Cambodia. Battamong, Sisaphorn, Siem Reap, even as rendered as towers. So this is their icon, is a facade, a shrine. Unveiled by a Franco-Khmer soldier who pulls back the French flag, revealing the French gift of Cambodia to itself. But yet this is the moment that Cambodia essentially becomes, in any meaningful use of that word, Cambodia. It's here. What we're talking about is the natural becoming of these kinds of spaces. Certainly you can use shorthand and talk about the history of Cambodia and Thailand in a given year or whatever, but if you're really being sort of specific, I think maybe Barbara has more to say about this. But I think this is a 19th century phenomenon. And it's here at the end of the 19th century and the eve of the 20th that these lines are being created, and these values associated with these lines are then being instilled. From the Thai perspective, the Siamese perspective, we have this discourse that the British also played into or played with, because they didn't like the French, that the French were predating on the Siamese. Right? So this is from Punch, and it's in the wake of the Franco-Siamese War. This is the war in which brief conflict, basically, where the French forced the Siamese kings to relinquish any claims they had to the side of the Mekong West, corresponding essentially to most of Laos, much of Laos. So whatever claims the Chakri kings have on these, and this is a whole another nationalistic discourse, right, between Laos and Thailand, very heated from that. But the Chakri kings being forced to relinquish whatever claims they had there, which were actually not very deep historical claims at all. So one way to think about this is not so much, in fact, that it was the French wolf predating on the Siamese land, but another perspective is to think about to what extent it was a Siamese wolf predating on Lao and Khmer land, if you're really going to use these kind of ethno-linguistic, nationalist kinds of perspectives. But at any rate, there was a parceling up of the landscape based on the idea of nation states. And there was a lot of culpability we could pass around in the operation. about it. Certainly the French, though, because we can't, I mean, historically, it's just kind of my perspective. The French mission at Angkor, underseen by Delacorte, took 3 trips to Angkor. Proceeded to work on the mines, did a lot of work, it's important work, a lot of important science, if you will, consolidated monuments. You can debate over the quality of restoration and whether or not some of the stuff they did was really in the best interest of the monuments, but they essentially over time, beginning with Delacorte and subsequently in the hands of the French School of the Far East, the EFEO, began systematic mapping and study and really wrote a modern history of Angkor and of Cambodia. Which, not really so much through colonial education, because there wasn't much of it, but over time, certainly became the national narrative for Cambodia. Today, as a young person who works in this region, who often disagrees with sort of what some of these French scholars says, I often find my worst critics are Cambodians who buy the French perspective more than French people, who actually themselves also want to criticize some of these earlier scholars. It's interesting that the history that they wrote is the Khmer history that ought not to be touched. It's the French history of Cambodia. Here they are clearing monuments, removing statues, taking them down river, putting them in museums. It's a whole new part of the discourse is the National Museum, present the nation to itself, and also characterize the success of the colonizing nation. So in Paris, where you show yourself as the resuscitator of this lost ancient civilization, and so a kind of you bear the legacy as well. Of course, a lot of this has to do with Angkor Wat and the civilization that it represents, as I said, metaphorically, metonymically, on all kinds of levels. There was Angkor Mania, to some extent, in France in the early decades of the 20th century, and it had to do with these colonial expositions, where these colonizing powers would try to display their success in their various colonial endeavors by the way that they educated the natives and the kind of resources that they were able to extract. There were really ways of kind of justifying the colonial enterprise to themselves and competing in various ways for national honor and all that sort of thing. But we have recurring iterations of Angkor Wat being made as a scale model. So it's somewhat similar to what King Manku did when he made a replica of Angkor Wat and brought it to Bangkok. We have the same thing going on literally in the form of the statues that are being brought to Paris, but also in these big mock-ups, these big scale renderings. And 1931 was the biggest spectacle of all. The pictures of this are crazy. It's really big. It's the core of Angkor, pretty much the scale. Not the whole monument, but the big central mound. And you went in and there was a museum, and it was laid out in this kind of teleological way to justify the civilizing mission of the French. Very interesting. No longer exists, but pieces of it. By the way, there's a big exhibit going on in Kime this month, where they're using a lot of the casts. They're sort of really exploring this now with regard to the actual, instead of just the imagery that survives in the journals and newspapers. Now, they brought all these casts out of storage that were made, used to make plastic casts and things to make these mock-ups. Pretty interesting. Of course, the circulation of the images, and especially the iconic towers of Angkor, have permeated international thinking and in Cambodia itself. So Van Mollebaum, of course, he's a famous architect. A lot of the big structures in post-independence Cambodia were his design, and he's famous in part also for the Independence Monument, which is specifically an evocation of this sort of stereotype Angkorian temple tower by Angkor Wat's tower. The national anthem, of course, in Cambodia is about Angkor. It's about a race of builder kings, right? And it's I'm expressly making this connection because in national discourse, the connection is indeed often made, though it's not necessarily implicit in these lyrics that I preach over the dialogue the same here. But the splendor of Mahanakhor, or Angkor, right? Like a rock, the Khmer race is eternal. A discourse that associated the ancient Cambodians with being stone masons and builders par excellence, right? And that their nation is eternal precisely because there was a concern and a discourse that continues to exist in Cambodia of the idea of a vanishing race of Cambodians. And again, it goes back to this discourse of Vietnamese and Thai international relations, if you want to say, depredations, kind of violations of Khmer sovereignty from the Khmer perspective. The idea of a vanishing Khmer race, very strong in Khmer thought, very similar to the idea in Thai thought of the theft of the land, by the French. That still plays out. It's, I mean, the word for Thai for treason is selling land, literally. Selling land is how you say treason in Thai. Angkor, Angkor Wat, a national logo. As a result of all this attention that was shown on these monuments, Angkor Wat shifted from being a ceremonial center to a national icon, a national logo, as the Cambodian nation emerged through colonialism and then through independence and post-independence. The lodestone, the guiding principle, was ancient Angkor. It's enshrined at every level, on every flag, except for Untaks, the UN period of occupation, right? This is Angkor seen from above. That's the Queen Cones of Towers, and the others are self-identified. It's the only national flag in the world that employs a monument. India comes close, because that wheel is an Ashokan wheel, but it's not actually, but it's detached, it's divorced from, it's just more abstracted, right? Because it's actually part of this lion capital, which was probably Buddhist. In Indian terms, right, they also use the spinning wheel and all that, so it's a reference to the chakra, the wheel, but it's not a monument itself. There are other would-be nations that utilize built material, but it's the only nation that uses one actually on its flag. It's the national icon, it's on their money. This is not unusual. Philippines, maybe every country in the world practices its national monuments. Vietnam, in the region, they very much use national monuments, but Angkor Wat is everywhere, always. So, though, is Pray the Here becoming? And it has a lot to do with the contest over the legacy of Angkor. And Angkor Wat, Pray the Here, is so valorized. Here's its famous fifth Gopura. Here's a view of it from the side. That's the Gopura. It's become iconic, second perhaps only to Angkor Wat now. And sometimes they're juxtaposed. So the recent battle, 2007, Pray the Here on one side, Angkor Wat on the other, rice farmers. The essential eternal values, right? Pray the Here. It really does hang in a kind of limbo. It's on the brink, right, as I said, right? It's right here on the edge of a cliff. It's a stunning location, right? It's really interesting. It's well worth a visit, though. You can visit today, but only from the Cambodian side of it. It's a functioning Buddhist monastery today, though the Thais claim that the Buddhist monks here are soldiers in disguise. I have no way to know whether that's true or not. Could be. Maybe not. There's a lot of cross claims and counter claims. So my intention is I talk a little bit about this now in my remaining time is not to take sides, but just to discuss the issues a little bit. This is the view that clearly you weren't really supposed to take in the way it was originally built, but this is looking out across Cambodia, 500 meters below the cliff here. Turn around, and these are more of the views that greet you. Vietnam War era, some sort of aircraft, right? Some old anti-aircraft guns, probably from the KR-80s, when it was used as a kind of base. Cambodian soldiers all over the site. Of course, the basis of the dispute is map. And so this has been well chronicled by a number of scholars and science and map Tong Kai especially, but others who have focused more directly on the Pray the Here issue. It has to do with the way that these states were formulated. And the way that that happened was that the French required it as they were wrangling with the Siamese court over exclusive claims to territory. They were also insisting that it be mapped. And this came out in various treaties, one in 1904, one in 1907, in which they agreed to delimit the border. And the result was this map, and this is the map that's at the center of the conflict over the temple. Because what it did was something unusual. The 1904 treaty that stipulated that such a map would be drawn said that it would be drawn based on the watershed on the right mountain range. That is where the water flows. So it flows this way, Thailand, flows that way, it's Cambodia. They got to Pray the Here, and clearly they knew the watershed flew into Thailand because the man himself says it in his own notes. But they diverged from the principle because they saw it as a Khmer temple. They diverged from the premise of the treaty and created a map that was then distributed by the French and given to the Thai court. And problematically for the Thai perspective, disseminated by them. But it put Pray the Here in Cambodia, even though the treaty put it in Thailand. So this came to the World Court. And the U.S., former U.S. Secretary of State, Dean Acheson, represented the Cambodians, Ray and Muthanger Pattai, who were at this time a close ally, of course, of the United States in Cold War politics, the last bastion against communism and all that that was emerging. But he was legal counsel for Cambodia, and he wove a very complicated web that is still trying to be interpreted today, reinterpreted by the courts, and asked to weigh back in on it. Cambodia won. There was a decision, I think, 9-3, on the justices at the International Court of Justice. It was precipitated by the fact that when Cambodia gained its independence, of course, in 1953, 1954, there was, Cambodia was expressing a renewed interest in its borders, of course. Thailand had taken up occupation of Prayer here because they saw it as their site. In fact, the site had been neglected, ignored, basically. And so history is wide open for interpretation. It's really in a really remote area even to this day. But the court ruled in favor of Cambodia. And they did it on the basis of a curious principle called estoppel, which was basically that a country cannot make a claim, a person or a country can't make a claim that contradicts some sort of prior action or words. In other words, the basis of the decision was silence. It was the fact that Thailand never rejected formally the maps that were made, that that meant that they tacitly accepted them. And that because Thailand, meanwhile, was benefiting from other international treaties, they couldn't claim benefit from these treaties while at the same time they're rejecting this one aspect of them. Thailand never really has accepted this, though. They kind of begrudgingly accepted the decision. They removed their personnel, their police, and their flag from the temple, but they didn't take the flag down. They uprooted the whole pole. It took it a few kilometers away and replanted it. Right? Now they say basically what's at stake here is a debate over the borderline, but the issue is that, in fact, the International Court of Justice did not do a very good job. Legally, they're very confused. You can read the whole proceedings. They're very interesting, if you don't mind that sort of stuff. But this use of estoppel is strange. Right, you have to make an overt declaration of objection to something. It means that every time something goes a little awry, you have to create a war over it, essentially what the principle is at play here, precedent. It's not very good. But the idea that silence on the part of the Thai is the justification for putting this on Cambodia is problematic because French and Cambodian people weren't making any claims on it either until the issue came to a head. Everybody was silent on the issue until there became a conflict. In other words, when you're faced with loss, that's when you start to create a narrative, right, and try to project it into the past. The decision then to be made is over this line because what, and by the way, International Court of Justice, their verdicts are, they're unappealable. So all they're going to do is clarify the ruling. They're likely not going to change it. But the problem is the ruling isn't very clear. What they said is the temple belongs to the sovereignty of Cambodia and the Thai authorities need to be removed from the vicinity of. Then the question is, what's the vicinity and where's the border? So Thailand has tended to take a very narrow view of the verdict and say, okay, the temple may be in Cambodia, but the land all around it is Thailand. Like up to the walls. Actually, the more extreme Thai version is that Prayer here is a cart. And the cart may belong to Cambodia, but the wheels are Thai. And so this has led to this ongoing struggle and competing map perspectives, right? Sanctuary here on this hill, where's the border? Which one is the border, right? And it's a militarized site. This came to a head, of course, in 2008, because Cambodia applied for World Heritage status for the month. This is very complicated. I'd like to discuss this at length, but due to time, I'm gonna summarize a little bit. This was based on a prior agreement, though, that Cambodia had made, Hun Sen, had made with former Prime Minister of Thailand, Thaksin Shinawat, very complicated arrangement, where he agreed to allow them to pursue unilateral World Heritage status. So it's again, when you're looking for international recognition that of these things, it suddenly becomes a conflict, right? Meanwhile, Thaksin had been ousted in a coup, right? And this became a matter for internal jockeying within Thailand, this issue. The idea that these politicians were selling out the land, they're committing treason in Thailand by cooperating with Cambodia to somehow acknowledge that this was a Cambodian temple. defended, it got hot, there were murder incursions, violations of protests, it was part of the whole red shirt, yellow shirt swallowing that's been going on in the following. Then it became a militarized site, a lot of civilians killed, entire villages having to be relocated, soldiers killed as well. So this is just some scenes of it. It's a zone of contest here. So we have, we can talk about these zones of interaction. But here we have one where they're really fighting over where's the line on the ground. We have to separate them. There's no concept at all that this could be shared space. Only international commentators make that argument, that there could be some sort of peaceable arrangement of sharing. But there's none of that coming from tired Cambodian authorities. When you look at that's quite interesting. It's very nationalized space. So these are the signs that greet you throughout the site. So it's the express linkage of this temple to what it means to be Cambodian. High stakes. So it was a great fanfare that the World Heritage status was given. And so it was a big party. In Odi, in Thailand, they're militarizing the border at this time. One of the issues, of course, is tourism. It's not just land and sovereignty, but it has a lot to do with international respect and integrity, territorial integrity. A lot to do also with money, connected to the incredible amounts of tourist dollars and just national esteem, international esteem, I should say, that comes with this kind of thing. The respectacalization of the site. This reminds me of 1931 in Paris here. Now we have light shows, very controversially being played out in Angkor Wat because it's said that they damaged it pretty badly installing all the lights. The firm that did it got in trouble, but it's a problem in Cambodia that the management of the sites is not what it should be. Of course, there's the whole sort of vulgarization, if you will, popularization. I don't think all pop culture is vulgar, but I do think this movie is, because it's just not very good. But it shows the filming that utilizes Angkor Wat and Top Home in the film. And so it brought a lot of attention, good or bad, to the site. And it's, again, sort of the steam that's being competed for. There's the whole consumerization thing. It goes all the way back to the French who repeatedly utilized, especially Angkor Wat, the iconic tower. Like I said, it was everywhere, really. It was such an icon of French colonialism that became then the icon of Cambodian nationhood. I understand the association if we think of this as palatial, even though, of course, I just told you it's a temple with a funerary association. So it's kind of ironic that it's being linked here to a luxury car, but you know, it's kind of extravagant luxury. But I don't really understand shotgun shells so well. I guess it's hung for skins and it's you're out in the middle of nowhere, I suppose. But why not?
And a dead elephant.
Here it is. But now, again, you can't just fault one party or the other. I mean, this is not Cambodia's fault. I mean, it's all over the place. It's the national beer, it's the national cigarettes. So nobody's immune to these forces, right? Pray to here too. It's got some here. The fifth gopher is the logo of the label. If we have time, I'd show you there. Maybe I can show you later. They have a stunning commercial that plays with national pride and parade here.
Let's look at it at lunch.
So we should stop, but I'll just wrap up by saying that largely the issue with parade here is as a matter of jockeying internal politics in each of the countries, but also then the relationship between two countries that really share a lot. There's a lot of cultural connections. In Southeast Asia, probably no two countries have more in common than Cambodia and Thailand in terms of their culture. And I would even say it overlaps Cambodia and Thailand, more than Thailand. Lots of people ethnically they're more connected. Just in terms of the long-standing relationships, a lot of cultural sharing, a lot of similarities, and tradition, and dance, and puppetry, not the same, but very closely related. But as we know, oftentimes the worst fights are family fights, so to speak, even though I'm not saying they're ethnically or linguistically, they're different, right? But you know, a lot of what we're dealing with here is a squabble that is deeply rooted in ways that only someone very close to you could exploit, right? Because they know what touches your buttons. Certainly that was the case with the ongoing war of words between Hun Sen, the longest heading reign of rule of state in the world right now, kind of a despotic character. In fact, thin veneer of democracy, but he rules with a kind of an iron fist. He said a person who was kind of buffeted by the political winds in Thailand, certainly kind of exploited the Prayutpaya controversy for his own brief political career. But I don't know if you were paid attention to the journalistic coverage of this, but it really deteriorated with Abhisit calling Hun Sen a villainous gangster, and Hun Sen putting a death curse on Abhisit. He went to give a speech in which he said that Abhisit denies that Thailand has violated, this was in the 2008 fighting, denies that they violated the territorial integrity of Cambodia. May he be struck dead by this, by that, may be poisoned, may his whole family burn up in a plane crash, and he listed like 30 ways that he ought to die in public. So this is a big deal. It has a lot to do with this figure, Thaksin, who worked the deal, but then was ousted in Thailand. But then was brought back in after he was in exile as a financial advisor by Hun Sen, just to sort of poke at the ties. It's a very interesting thing, though, because what it shows is that you have a changing configuration of power in the region. For a long time, Thailand was the dominant party in its political relationship and was able to influence and meddle in internal Thai politics, or Cambodian politics. Hun Sen has flipped the switch. He's manipulating politics in Thailand by inviting the red shirts to come and hang out in Cambodia and have conventions, inviting Thaksin in as an advisor and sort of thing. Thaksin's sister is now in power, and things are pretty good between them. But this is based on the fact that Cambodia and Thailand are waiting, both with bated breath, for the World Court, International Court of Justice, to clarify that decision in 1952. What is the vicinity of breaking? Now, on both sides, they're pretty fearful that either way, it's going to go bad for somebody, and it's pretty much acknowledged there's no way it's going to be peaceful. The International Court of Justice cannot decide this. This is a matter that's too complicated for a legal outcome. There has to be some sort of outcome that benefits stakeholders on both sides. There has to be something where there's a meeting of the minds or coming to terms with the authorities in these countries, and an agreement to stop jockeying over it like for sort of short-term political gain. It's really about how we reflect on the past. And can two countries share an historical legacy? But clearly they both do share, and they differently make claims to. Can it be shared? So we're done. I have a few things that I brought here for Jan's not here anyway. This shows some contemporary work, but if
she'll talk, be back.
We can do it on Saturday.
She had a dashboard class.
Yeah.
Do we have one or two questions?
Yes. Absolutely fascinating, because it's so hard to hear about Hinduism to that extent in USA. Also being in my field is English literature, so not exactly my field, but that's my heritage. Mm-hmm. So Hinduism. Mm-hmm. So I have comment very briefly. I want to make the comment that from part two or part three, where you mentioned that intersection between the transcendence and immanence being represented in the temple, that was very accurate and absolutely fascinating. And well, the question was raised about the community gathering, you know, during the about Hindu ceremony or festival.
Sure.
I just want to add that we do have it when we have, like now, afterwards the month of the festival for the Hindus.
Yeah.
And here also in a lot of temples, and on those like goddess worships, you go to the temple and have that kind of congregation. But basically the personal relation with God,
yeah,
it's very, like in my home there's a temple, it's like each household has a sort of, they
establish
it. That was so...
You're absolutely right, but I think I just wanted to clarify with that conversation, what we were talking about was how we interpret these smaller architectural spaces.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're absolutely right that in Hinduism, and I think we have historical records of big festivals in Angkor, too, key to Palo Alto in that case, because that's where our respective sort of inscriptions. But even in Hinduism, where when we have these festivals, of course, it's not the case that the people are gathering in a big community hall to listen to a sermon. Those spaces are quite small, and as you know, it's fun. You go in there and you're kind of pushed around trying to go through to worship at these in these festival events. But the architecture itself is not designed as congregational space like a mosque or a cathedral. It's designed as a house of God. And you gather sometimes as communities, but you don't gather for community worship per se. It's more of a kind of
special occasion. So then I think and they agree that like right now in Calcutta, India, they're having this goddess festival. And it turns to a cultural festival and sometimes it becomes a commercial.
Yeah.
So it took such a huge start. And if I may very briefly comment on or question you about the parallelism I saw, the way it evolved, like in 12th century we have Chandragupta Maurya, Pallavas, and the Cholas, those Indian Hindu kings. But then the parallelism that was very interesting to see when India was invaded by British, almost at the same time it's happening, you know, in the Southeast Asia, French.
A little earlier, but sort of. There are some really interesting similarities and parallels with regard to the way that regional kingdoms were colonized at some different times, but in resulting in very different kind of regional identities. I mean, India, as we know, there's a distinct tribal identity that is somewhat uneasily connected to the national identity, right? Mm-hmm. And there's similar kinds of parallels as we can see in Southeast Asia too. Colonialism, it created new identities, it created certain unified identities, but it also revealed or created new lines of cleavage as well, of course.